Where we were going to pick up today, notice my verb tense there, I think was chapter 21. We're not. We're jumping ahead to chapter 23, and I want us to pick up around page 230. So what little bit am I skipping? Bartimaeus, when he is interviewed briefly by Jessica Whitwell in the Tower of London, and she tells him, oh, by the way, you're in a mournful orb. What does that mean? He's been imprisoned in this sphere, and what will it gradually do? It'll get smaller and smaller and smaller. Right now, it's large enough for him in his gargoyle shape, I think it is. But it'll keep shrinking, and as it shrinks, he can keep shrinking. But it will eventually become what? Nothing. Being something, he can't become nothing without becoming nothing and psh, out of existence. Okay? So he's kind of in a tight spot, you could say. So where I want to pick up on page 230 is when Arthur Underwood comes up to his room because he has this stench of incense on him. He comes in, he sees the incense pot. We talked about this the other day. He kicks aside the rug. He sees Adelbrandt's pentacle and says, you've tried or attempted to summon a genie of at least the 14th level and even tried to bind it. He says, I wouldn't even do that. Something I would balk at. Meaning, I'm not even that advanced. Okay? So Nathaniel's in pretty, he's in pretty sorry shape here. So he leaves him there for a bit, and he goes downstairs, and Nathaniel tries to talk to Mrs. Underwood, and she's like, oh, your master's very upset. I'm not going to talk with you about this, blah, 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 blah. And he discovers from her that one of the reasons Underwood is so upset is because there's trouble down in central London. A genie has been captured and is now in the tower and being questioned. And Nathaniel, being not a dumb person, puts two and two together and realizes it's his genie. And he's thinking, what will he do? Will he spill the beans on me? Okay. So he conjures up his little imp in the scrying glass, and he has the imp do some things. And he shows Nathaniel what's going on at the tower and such. And we go back to Bartimaeus in chapter 24. And I'm going to skip a bunch. And Bartimaeus is in the tower. And who shows up? Who are his rescuers? Fakoral and Jabor. The two that he actually got past when he stole the amulet of Samarkand at the beginning of the story. They are genies in the service / enslavement of Simon Lovelace. Okay? What else have we heard about Fakoral and Jabor before? What kind of relationship do they have with Bartimaeus?
Not the greatest.
Not very good. How long have they known each other? Millennia. Okay. Have they ever really apparently served on the same side? No. Though we are going to hear at the very end of the novel, what does Bartimaeus actually think of Fakoral? You know, if you're going to conjure up an... He tells Nat, call up Fakoral. He'll do the job for you. You know, he's pretty good. Jabor's not around anymore by that point. Okay. So... Fakoral and Jabor get them out, and Bartimaeus escapes from them and makes his way back to Highgate. And we pick up with chapter 26. And John's asking again, or Nathaniel's asking Mrs. Underwood again for more information. And page 262, she's like, heavens, John, will you never stop asking questions? He said a great deal, but nothing I'm going to share with you. Pan of water on downstairs. I have to make him something quickly. Eat your sandwich. He's locked in his study. So, Nathaniel sends the imp in the scrying class down into his master's study. And he overhears this conversation. Right? And what do we hear? Underwood wants to investigate this genie. He thinks the genie has something to do with the theft of magical objects and such. And he realizes when the imp says, I can't get any closer, because Nathaniel can't hear the conversation, and he forces him to get closer, Underwood perceives that the imp is there. And he comes up, you know, an appearance of him, an apparition of him, comes up through the floor and sees Nathaniel staring at the scrying glass. So he's caught, you know, dead to rights. I mean. And the imp, page 269, after Underwood says, you're dead, and goes back down, the imp says, what's the matter? You're a big magician now. This is the bottom of 269. Call something up to save your skin. And a freak, maybe. That should do the job. But what about that Bartimaeus you're so obsessed with? Where is he when you need him? With a sob, Nathaniel stumbles back into the center of the room and turns slowly to face the door. Nasty ate it, the imp says, being at someone else's mercy. Now you know what it feels like. Face it, kid, you're on your own. You've got no one there to help you. So what does the imp mean there? Nasty ain't it, being at someone else's mercy. Tables are turned, right? How often have the tables been turned on Nathaniel? How often has he felt what it feels like to be a genie? Or, another way of putting it, what it feels like to be a commoner? Not at all. Does he ever empathize with those people? Meaning, genies or commoners? No, not at all. Never does he identify with them. And there's Bartimaeus back. Okay? So, Underwood comes in. Who taught you to do this? Who has you spying on me? Notice, he makes the same assumption Bartimaeus makes. You can't be doing this on your own. Somebody else has put you up to this. And while he's up there berating Nathaniel and planning whatever he's going to do to him, Simon Lovelace shows up downstairs. Nathaniel's days just keep getting better and better and better. Underwood leaves, and 273, we see Bartimaeus, who's been a naughty little magician then. Underwood's cotton on to you at last, I see. Took his time. Right? Nathaniel, you brought Lovelace here. Don't lie to me, demon. You've betrayed me. Where is he? Downstairs. No, I've got a tobacco tin to think of. Why would I be stupid enough to lead him here? Though we do find out he did lead him there. Not Lovelace personally, but for Quarrel and Jabor. Okay? So, Nathaniel tries to issue a command. Oh, 274, oh, can it, Nat? You're not in the pentacle now. You can't force me to obey each new order. How strong is Underwood? Why? What? How strong? What level? Not strong enough for Lovelace. Okay? So, what does Bartimaeus do? He gets all obsequious and he kind of fawns on Nathaniel and says, bottom of 274, know ye that I have devotedly carried out my charge. I have spied on Lovelace. I have sought the secrets of the amulet. I have risked all for you, O my master. And the results are, you're an idiot. So he uses all this wonderful flowery language. You've no idea what you've done. The amulet is so powerful, it's been in government keeping for decades until Lovelace had it stolen. And in those circumstances, I don't think it's likely he'll worry about killing Underwood to retrieve it. Notice, that thought hasn't really crossed Nathaniel's mind. Bartimaeus plants it. Your master's a dead man. We've got to do something. True. I'll go watch developments. You get ready to run. I'm not running anywhere. Mrs. Underwood, let me give you a little tip from long experience. Running's good if your skin needs saving. Better get used to the idea, bud. Bud, go up to your room. Wait. I'll tell you what happens soon enough. Be prepared to move fast. Okay? So we go down to watch the interview of Underwood and Lovelace. Lovelace accuses Underwood of having stolen something. Page 281, Lovelace says, "You pompous upstart, how dare you accuse me of theft? I haven't got your object. I know nothing of it. You're not worth harming. No one knows, everyone knows your star has waned. You're not worth harming. No, your agents have got it wrong. Or probably they lie." Okay? So, Underwood has his demon start to what? Trash the dining room. Starting with this old family heirloom dining room table. And they've got this thing about ripped in two. Can't really see the rip. And Mrs. Underwood, "Darling, I brought tea and puppets." And so, you know, Lovelace is kind of sit there. "Thank you, Mrs. Underwood," and argues. She leaves and the table collapses. Right. Lovelace gives three whistles, commands his Ginny, and Underwood, we're told, 285, was on his knees beside the ruins of his tea service. Which way to your study, Arthur? So he leads him to his study. Nathaniel, meanwhile, is back upstairs. He's standing on the landing. He's listening. Everything that happens in the dining room happens behind closed doors. But he can hear raised voices. And we're told. He hears Mrs. Underwood bringing the tea. He hears the clinking of the china. 287. In that moment, Nathaniel quite forgot his own predicament. Mrs. Underwood was in danger. The enemy was in the house. In a few moments, he would doubtless force or persuade Underwood to open his study for inspection. Amulet would be found. And then, what might Lovelace do to Mr. Underwood or his wife? And he's thinking, Bartimaeus told me to stay up here. But he doesn't. Okay? He heads off downstairs. He realizes they're in the study. Okay? He hears, overhears conversation. On page 289, Nathaniel's head sank into his hands. He could not run, he could not hide. That was the advice of a demon, treacherous and sly. Running and hiding were not the actions of an honorable magician. If he let his master face Lovelace alone, how would he live with himself again? When his master suffered, Mrs. Underwood would suffer too. That would be impossible to bear. No, there was no help for it. Now that the crisis was upon him, Nathaniel found, to his surprise and horror, he had to act. To run would be to fail Mrs. Underwood. Okay? So, Underwood keeps saying, "I don't know what you're talking about," to Lovelace. "I don't know any Bartimaeus. I don't have your amulet." And bottom of 290, Lovelace pulls the amulet out, and he's like, "I don't know how it got there." And Nathaniel hears a new voice, bottom of 290, speaking high and shaky. It was his own. He's telling the truth. I took it. Person one is me. It was I. He knows nothing about it. You can leave him alone. Underwood blinks, shakes his head. He can't believe what's going on. It's like he's living in a fantasy land. He clears his throat again. "What are you gibbering? Get out of here, boy!" It hasn't registered. "A moment, Arthur. Perhaps you're being too hasty." So Lovelace turns to Nathaniel, and Underwood says, "You can't be serious." Lovelace, "And raise a genie of the 14th level? That too?" "Exactly. I mean, he's..." And he remembers the pentacle. "I caught him this afternoon trying to do a summoning." Nathaniel, bottom of 292, says, "It was just a trick. a joke. I wanted to get back at you for hitting me that time. I asked the demon to take something of yours, anything at all. I was going to keep that thing till I was older and thought till I could find out what it was and how to use it. Hope it wasn't valuable. Very sorry. Let me lick your boots, sir. Okay. Underwood turns on him. Last straw, I'm going to get you out of here. Sorry, Simon, I'm sorry. I can only apologize, Lovelace. What did he say to Lovelace earlier in the dining room? You're a nobody. Why would I want to harm you? And now he's sucking up to him. The color drained from Underwood's cheeks. His eyes darted towards Lovelace's face to see if he had noticed anything. Okay. Well, John Mandrake, 293, I'm almost very impressed. Notice, I'm not quite, but I'm almost. You've inconvenienced me. You know, it's pretty advanced magic for you to summon a genie such as Bartimaeus at your age to control him. Yeah, you frustrated me. Underwood tries to speak. Lovelace shuts him off, says, I want to hear his reasons. Some childish concept of nobility, is it? Guessed as much. The honorable course of action? Heroic, but stupid. Where did you get that notion from? So, notice what Lovelace says about honor and heroism. Childish and stupid. Okay? I robbed you because you wronged me. I wanted to get back at you. It's all there is to it. Notice, that's not honorable, nor is it heroic. What is it? Well, it's not necessarily childish. It's just pure revenge. That's all it is. Revenge. I wanted to revenge. Get my revenge on you. Okay? Underwoods, you know, see, I'm not guilty. You can't touch me. He goes, don't worry, Arthur. I'll administer punishment once I dispose of you. Okay. Why does he need to dispose of Arthur? Well, go back for a moment to page 293. I can only apologize, Lovelace. Underwood drew himself up and puffed out his chest. We have both been inconvenienced. He has betrayed me, and from you, he has stolen the most powerful treasure, this amulet. And he stops. Because once the word is out of his mouth, he knows what it is. And once he knows what it is, that's when he has to be taken care of. That's when he realizes, I don't get a walk out of here. That's why the color drains from his cheeks. That's why he looks to see if there's any change in Lovelace's eyes. Okay? So, Underwood tries to, you know, suck up to him and say, you can trust me, I won't give anything away. But the boy must be silenced before he blabs. Kill him now, page 295, and the matter will be finished. And Lovelace says, such loyalty from a master to his apprentice. Very touching. You see, John, Underwood and I are giving you a final lesson in the art of being a magician. We're still teaching you. And perhaps with our help, you'll understand your error in owning up to me today. Interesting little lesson he learns here. You still believe in the notion of the honorable magician who takes responsibility for his actions. Mere propaganda. What is propaganda?
Advertisements.
Is it just advertisements?
False information.
Louder?
False information.
From?
Source.
Yeah, from the government. Propaganda is usually from the government. Okay? It can be from a lower ranking political source within the government, but, you know, turning on the boob tube and watching some situation comedy or something, that's not going to give you propaganda. Propaganda is going to come usually from the government through what? Through the media. Okay. Yeah, dear, you know, the dear leader. The all-imperious one, you know. It'd be like if the government were to suddenly start referring to Trump as His Majesty, we would know we're not in Kansas anymore. There's a problem there, okay? Or the Supreme Leader, as Kim Jong-un is called, okay? Mere propaganda. What does he mean? Such a thing does not exist. So who's the propaganda for? Commoners and lower level magicians. In other words, the magicians at the top of the food chain, they don't believe this propaganda, but the lower level ones do, like Underwood to an extent. There is no honor, no nobility, no justice. No honor, no nobility, that is, you can't act nobly. And there is no justice. Every magician acts only for himself. So what's the basis of all magical behavior? Me. That's it. It's all about me. It's not about you. Right? With the magician world is, would be this. It's all about me. Okay? How do you think the prime minister came into power, he says? His master killed the previous prime minister. That is how things are always done. When I use the amulet next week, I will be following in a grand tradition, reaching back to Gladstone. Now, is this just complete, utter nonsense? Is this just complete and utter fantasy? No, it's not. Through probably the vast majority of countries in the world, this is how things are done. It's the amazing thing about the American constitutional system. Every 4 years, we celebrate either the transfer, the peaceful transfer of power, or the continuation, and then after 4 years, the peaceful transfer of power. I mean, what we witnessed in January, if you haven't thought about this, is really, truly amazing to go from the administration of the previous 8 years to the current administration. That's the, other than 1980, that is the clearest break that we've had in probably 100 years. Okay. I mean, it is so stark, the difference between Reagan and Carter and the difference between Trump and Obama. Doesn't get much darker than that unless you go back to, oh, I don't know, Lenin and Tsar Nicholas. That's a pretty stark difference. But that wasn't the peaceful transfer of power. Okay? You know, England now has a peaceful transfer of power, but it wasn't always that way. You had people killing off kings, 1649, for example, when the king was legally put to death by Parliament for abusing his power. It used to happen in France all the time. I mean, Napoleon, and all the way up to like Napoleon III in the mid-1840s. So he goes on. You should know, I was resolved to kill everybody in this house before I even got here. An image of Mrs. Underwood downstairs in the kitchen flashed through the fan's mind. Please. You're weak, boy, just like your master. And what happens? Bartimaeus saves his bacon, picks him up, leaves, takes him upstairs, sets him on the landing, and what does Nathaniel do? Starts back downstairs. Damn fool. Save yourself. Okay. Mrs. Underwood, Nathaniel cries on page 299. Are you? Takes him back again. His face went blank. But my master, page 300, is dead. Mrs. Underwood, with her husband. You can't help her now. No, it's my fault. I must find her. Stop struggling. Haven't you made enough useless? Mrs. Underwood would not want you to die too. Yes, it is your fault, but don't blame yourself. I love this little passage here. What's Bartimaeus trying to do? Console him and save him. Why? Because he's saving himself. First and foremost. Is there another reason? Is Bartimaeus acting entirely out of self-interest here? I don't think he is. I think Bartimaeus actually shows us more of what it means to be a human, being a genie, than any other humans do within the story. Okay? Notice, he says, psychology of this, not my strong suit. I haven't a clue what motivates most humans, and I care even less. With magicians, it's usually pretty simple. That is, what motivates them? Ambition, greed, paranoia. Underwood, paranoid. Loveless, pretty much ambition. The kid, yeah, he's ambitious, but he's unformed. What does he mean, he's unformed? Naive, what else? He's uncorrupted. He hasn't been taught enough yet by a magician. So what kind of magician would it take to really turn Nathaniel into a Simon Lovelace? Who's he end up with? Jessica Whitwell. What is her position in the government? She's the Minister for Security. She's in charge of the secret police, the night police, the vigilant spheres, all of those things. She's MI5 and MI6, all wrapped up. She's the NSA, the FBI, and the CIA, all wrapped into one ball. What will she teach Nathaniel? How to get power. Okay? Which is why Bartimaeus is going to give him a little bit of advice. So, the boy was of the ambitious kind as well, but he was still young, unformed. Hence, this sudden, ridiculous burst of altruism. What's altruism? Okay, it can take the form of sacrifice. That would be extreme altruism. What else can it be? You see a homeless guy on the side of the road, you give him $5. Why? You feel bad that they're homeless. In other words, it's kind of an expression of or feeling a pity for somebody else, so you do something about it. There's a big difference between walking by a homeless person and saying, oh man, it sucks to be homeless, and then just go on your merry way. And walking by a homeless person and saying, oh man, it sucks to be homeless, here, and helping them out. The second act is an act of mercy. Why? You can do something to change that situation. Maybe not for a lifetime, but you might be able to ease a hunger pang for a day, right? What's Bartimaeus saying about Nathaniel at this point in his life? Is it all about me?
No, it's not.
Not yet. In other words, he does still have a conscience. He does still think of others. Not much. How much did he think about the commoners on the way down to Parliament? Not at all. Which is why it's going to be important that he has a little run-in with some commoners. He rubs shoulders, so to speak, meaning they beat the snot out of him. So, they leave, they get away from there, and Bartimaeus, let's see here, they escape from Jabor, and Bartimaeus takes him away to an empty, decrepit building. We find out it's a library. Nathaniel's freezing cold because he's just wearing like t-shirts. It's December, we find out, and it's London. December in London, t-shirts isn't going to cut it, okay? And so he kind of describes the room and such. Three 11, Bartimaeus says, you're shivering, but then you're hardly dressed for a winter's expedition. What have you got under that jersey? Just a shirt, I expect? And look at those flimsy shoes. They must be soaked right through. This isn't the place to be half naked. Look at it. Cracks in the ceiling, hole in the walls, hole in the ceiling. Do you want me to help you with the cold? I could. All you have to do is ask. Nathaniel doesn't respond. I can make a fire, a nice hot one. Look, tiny flame flickers in his palm. What was this place, do you think? A library? I think so. Don't suppose the commoners are allowed to read much anymore, are they? It's usually the way it goes. Why not? What about it?
Knowledge,
power. Knowledge is power. Okay, notice the difference between this set of books and if you've read them, the Harry Potter set of books. If we were in the Harry Potter world and we were muggles, we could read all the magical books in the world. Wouldn't do us a lick of good. We can't learn magic. You're born with it. Here, however, it's all in books. So books have to be kept away from certain people. Gee, do you think Jonathan Stroud just throws that in because that's great fantasy? Why not then? I have this written up here. If you're not familiar with it, Fahrenheit 451, written by Ray Bradbury in 1950, which I always tell my students, the most important book written in the 20th century. Hands down. It's about censorship and book burning. It's not about censorship in the First Amendment sense, meaning it's not about Donald Trump telling us you can't read that book. It's not about the government saying you can't read that book. Where in Fahrenheit 451 does the censorship come from? Us. And people like us. Who say, I don't think you should read that book. You shouldn't be reading this book. You know why? It's about witches and wizards and demons. The Bible says having anything to do with witches, wizards, and demons is wrong. Therefore, because I think it's wrong, you can't read it. Okay? Why else? Schools regularly ban Mark Twain's Huckleberry Finn. Why? No, nope. Not because it's about gay people.
You can't read it in my school because of it.
Seriously?
I come from a tiny, backwards country town. Listed.
Wow. Like, I'd never heard that before. Literally, I'd never heard that charge.
Yeah, we would not read that book. It's the same. In my school, if you got caught with some books, you could be written up.
Well, yeah, I mean, because books are dangerous. No, it's because of one of its main characters. Nigger Jim.
Mm-hmm.
It's got that word in it. That word that seemingly blows up people's minds if they just hear it. Turn on the radio for blankety blank sake. Okay? But we can't say that word. Yeah, but that word was pretty popular in 1850 or in the late 19th century when the book was written. Okay? So. Any book that has that word, get rid of it. Bradbury has this wonderful passage in there where he talks about the kind of people who want to ban books. And you know what he does? He does this. Hyphens. The hyphenated groups. So it could be Chinese Americans. And he just goes on and on and on with one hyphen after another. This is in 1950, before there were hyphenated Americans. Okay? What's he saying? It's people being offended by books that causes books to be banned. Okay? Why? Because we're told by a character in the novel, books in the hands of the wrong people are a loaded weapon. Well, what if those books are books of spells? And the spells really can summon demons. Get rid of the libraries. So what are we left with if we get rid of all the dangerous books? How many of you are familiar with Fahrenheit 451? So what do they have in their homes?
We've got the closing scene where books are burning.
Well,
the Bible wasn't.
Yeah, you got that, but what else? What does Montag have in his house? And his wife wants The fourth one. The wall screens. Wall TVs. Okay. Not quite a wall TV, but pretty close. You can, if you have the money, you can get a 12-foot TV. TV. Not video projector in screen. 12-foot TV. Okay. And some of you have them around your head and stuff. Earbuds, so that people go for walks. Families will go for walks, and everybody in the family will have earbuds on, and they're on their phone. Mind non morons, okay? You have only to ask, O Master, that is, and I'll make the flame bigger. Okay? What's, you know, Stroud, he just touches on it. He doesn't jump in as much as like I do, right? So, page 312, bottom. Bartimaeus is still talking. He says, you know, you're a piece of work. You're an interesting specimen, he says. I've known a fair few magicians in my time. There aren't many who are quite as suicidal as you. Most would think that popping in to tell a powerful enemy you pinch his treasure. Not a bright idea. You, all in a day's work. I had to. Sure, you had a brilliant plan, which was be silent. That was your plan? To be silent? Simple one, I'll say that. But remember, it was my life you were risking too. In other words, I wasn't going to let you get killed. I had another master like you once. He had the same mulish obstinacy, seldom acted in his own best interests. Didn't live long. Never mind, all's well that lives well. Who's he talking about? Ptolemy. The boy whose form he has now taken. Okay. Notice what he said about him. Seldom acted in his own best interests. So if he didn't act in his own best interests, what's the opposite of that? He acted in others' best interests. That's altruism. He's not focused on the me, he's focused on the you, or on the others. So, you got any other good plans? You should probably skip town, head off to Prague. You don't want to go to Prague, you want to become a, okay, head off to the country, become a laborer. Work on the trains, that'd be good for you, Nat. Build up some muscle, because you're a scrawny little runt. What does Nat think of those ideas? Not so keen on them, why? That's commoner work. No, he's a magician. He's going to work how? With his mind. Supposedly like politicians do. Okay? Supposedly. Page 314. Shut up, Nathaniel says. I don't need your suggestions. Stumbled to his feet, eyes blazing with anger. The Jinni's jibes had cut through his weariness and grief to ignite a pent-up fury that suddenly consumed him. Do you think maybe that was just a little bit what Bartimaeus had in mind? He needed to shock him out of his shock. Lovelace had said there was no such thing as honor, that every magician acted only for himself. Very well. Okay, this is Nathaniel thinking. Nathaniel would take him at his word. He would not make such a mistake again. So now he's going to pattern his life after the slime ball that is Simon Lovelace. Because Lovelace said there's no such thing as honor, he's going to take him and follow him? Really? Is that his only option? Huh. Bartimaeus says, 315. When he says, you want to go out in a blaze of glory against Lovelace. No, I want justice. No. Your pride is ruling your head, leading you to your death. Does he really want justice? No. What would justice be? Here. What would justice for Simon Lovelace be? Him going to jail for killing two people, actually three, because of the minister that had been murdered when the amulet was stolen, for a conspiracy to commit murder, conspiracy to commit mass murder. Okay. So going to the Tower of London for a long time, maybe for life, or possibly capital punishment. Okay. So what's Nathaniel about? What's he want? He wants revenge. Revenge is never justice. Never. It might feel like justice if you get hold of the person who raped your wife and daughters. Okay? But that's not justice. Didn't last night teach you anything? You're no match for him. Give it up. Never. I mean, you're not even really a magician anymore. You got any incense? You got any candles? Well, how are you going to do something? Okay? I have my scrying glass. Ooh. How long is he going to have that? They start to talk about what Lovelace said. He said, I have to figure out where this conference is. They buy the paper. Bartimaeus says, well, gee, we can look right here in the parliamentary section where it talks about the conference. So he looks in the scrying glass. The imp tells him, Hedleham Halls, 50 miles south of London. He sends Bartimaeus off to scout out the place. What does he do while Bartimaeus is gone? Takes a little nap. He gets up. Bartimaeus is still gone. And he goes outside to buy another paper. What happens while he's out buying the paper? Anybody? Who sees him? Or, let me put it more specific, more precisely. Who sees what he's carrying? Stanley the paperboy. Okay? Is that because he's got his coat and the scrying glass is sitting out of the pocket? No, it's in an inside pocket. So he follows Stanley the paperboy and takes him to Fred the paperboy. And he tells Fred he's got it on him right now. But then I was like, what's he talking about? But you want to just give us that divining glass? He's like, how do you know about that? And then Fred and Stanley take him to Kitty. What does Fred offer to Kitty to do to Nathaniel after they take the scrying glass from him? You want me to slit his throat? He says that pretty casually. And Fred's only like 14 or 15. He says it like, you know, yeah, exactly. Right, this got enough, you know, under my belt already. And she says, no, he's just a kid. How old is Kitty? She's about the same age as Nathaniel. Okay? So these commoners somehow, as we saw already with Bartimaeus, somehow can see magical objects. But notice when they see Bartimaeus what they don't see in Bartimaeus. They don't see that he's a genie. They see the magical object on him, the amulet, but they don't see the aura of the other place, the magic that is he himself. Okay? So, Bartimaeus goes back, goes off. He then comes back. Let's see here. Comes back. Nathaniel tells him what happened. And Bartimaeus was like, you know, you shouldn't have left. And I want to pick up with page 345. Nathaniel finally makes it back. Bartimaeus has been back for hours. And Bartimaeus says, well, this makes a pleasant change. Usually it's the genie who comes in worn out, covered in muck. I approve of such innovations. In other words, the world would be a much better place if magicians, you know. What made you leave the library? Did Lovelace's forces find you? Did Jabor break in? Went to get a newspaper. And he says, two commoners. See, that's what angers him more than anything. It was commoners who beat him up and took the scrying glass from him. He mentions the girl, and Bartimaeus was like, girl? Okay. So he tells them about the defenses he finds around Hedelin Hall. How easy is it going to be to get into this conference? Yeah, good luck. It's like getting into the White House. Okay, it's got two domes over it. You can't see the domes, but they're visible, I think, on what it is, the seventh level. You've got sentries outside that check everybody going in and out. But they can get there. So Bartimaeus, let's see here, helps him get down to Hedelin Hall. I'm going to skip a bit. Yeah, and all that. And how do they get in? Steal the grocery van. Squalls and Sons. Bartimaeus takes the role of Squall and Nathaniel takes the role of Son. Grocery truck is delivering all kinds of food goods for the conference. How do they get into the actual hall itself, into the actual house? How does Bartimaeus get in? Does he go in as his genie self? Does he go in as Ptolemy? Just wander around in a, you know, loincloth? No. What does he do? He starts to go in, and who does he see in the kitchen? For some reason, he likes to take the form of a cook. It's the form he served in Lovelace's house. Okay? We're going to see Fakoral in other books, and we're going to see him as a cook in other books. Okay? Poor Jabor, he goes the way of all flesh at the end of this book. All right? No, Bartimaeus takes the form of a lizard, crawls all over the outside of the house, and it's when he's on the outside of the house that he sees this addition, and he notices some interesting things about the addition. The glass isn't just regular glass. It's got like steel throughout it, and then there's all kinds of magical protection around here, and the floor is kind of different too, but he's not quite sure what it is about the floor. But he does eventually find a window that he sneaks in. What about Nathaniel? What does he do to actually get in the house? And I don't mean get in the house as Squall's son carrying baskets of food. I mean to get in the house and stay in the house. Knocks out a page boy. Okay. Puts on his uniform. Ties him up. Locks him in a toilet. And so he starts serving food. That starts, chapter 37 is where that picks up. Nathaniel's thinking, beginning of that chapter, you know, he's going to get his revenge. Page 384. He's got his tray of canapes, and he's walking around, and he goes in a room, and there's a young lady, turns out to be Amanda Cathcart, and she says some unkind things to him because, you know, the food's a mess because he spilled it all over the floor when he knocked the kid out. And we're told at the top of that page 384, when she tells him to leave, the guilt that had beset him after the fire had now hardened into a cold acceptance of his situation. Mrs. Underwood had died because he had stolen the amulet. She had died. Nathaniel had survived. So be it. Now he would destroy Lovelace in his turn. He knew the likelihood was that he would not survive the day. This did not worry him. In other words, he's willing to go out in a blaze of glory. The odds were stacked in his enemy's favor, but that was the way it should be. He would succeed or die trying. The certain heroism in this equation appealed to him. It was clear and simple. Me against Lovelace. And kind of like whoever dies in the process, so be it. It helped block out the messiness of his conscience. Okay, now keep in mind, who is our narrator? It's Bartimaeus. Okay? So what does he mean? It helped block out the messiness of his conscience. That and Mrs. Underwood died because of my actions. I'm not going to think about that. I'm going to get revenge on him. Other people might die. I can't think about that. That's the messiness of his conscience. Everything else he pushes away. So he goes down to the central hall where there are 300 ministers of government and their wives and girlfriends and mistresses probably and husbands and gigolos and you know, whoever else. Okay? So, bottom of 384. No one spoke to him or even seemed to see him. Several times his head was struck by an arm or hand blindly reaching out toward the platter or raising a canapé to an open mouth. In seconds, the uppermost dish is empty. He goes out of the room, out of breath, with his collar awry. Why is his collar awry? Because he's being buffeted by these people who are just reaching for food. A tall, lugubrious-looking servant was standing near him, filling glasses from a bottle. Like animals, ain't they? Bloody magicians. What's he mean? Well, we're going to hear a servant on the next page say, thirsty as camels. But camels have better manners. So what's that tell us about the magicians? Or the political class, you can say. Snobby, arrogant, belligerent. Pretentious. Supposedly, the higher in status you rise, what is also supposed to rise? Your manners. Okay? In the Republican election for who would be the Republican nominee, there was an incident, I'm pretty sure it was John Kasich, governor of Ohio, where Kasich was caught on film eating a piece of pizza. And talking at the same time. So he's shoveling a piece of pizza in his mouth and he's talking with somebody, a reporter, I believe. And Trump saw it and he's like, look at this guy, what a slob. Essentially saying, he has no manners. He has no manners. Okay? Well, if you listen to Kasich, what does he always say? What's his background? Dad was a postman. In other words, I rose from nothing. I was nothing but a tadpole in the pond, and I became governor, you know. Meanwhile, Trump was born, you know, as Ann Richards would say, of George H.W. Bush in 1988, with a silver spoon in his mouth. Actually, she said a silver foot in his mouth. He kept, right? Why this little bit of description? What is Stroud saying? What kind of people are in the magicians? Not nice. They're not nice. How do they treat those beneath them? Like those beneath them.
Yeah.
Okay. Listen to accounts by Secret Service agents, cops on Capitol Hill, about how representatives, senators, and their spouses treat them. Or you know, Secret Service agents, how former presidents and their wives treat them, okay? There's a great line from the Harry Potter novels. You want to take the measure of a man, look at how he treats his inferiors. Sirius Black tells Harry that, okay? So, we see the prime minister come in, and how does he appear? How does he come in? He's got four burly bodyguards around him, and he's got a 6 foot tall efreet behind him. Big Jenny, you know. What's he showing there? Showing his power. This is like when the president goes to another country. Why do they fly two Air Force Ones? One of them is to bring the black limo. Can't forget what it's called. It's got a nickname. Beast. The Beast. Armor plated. This thing weighs something like 10 or 12 tons. Because it's got inch thick steel armor plating. The glass in it is like the reinforced airline glass. You know, you can shoot a bazooka at it. It won't burst through. Can survive a chemical attack. I mean, they take that everywhere, okay? Plus all the Secret Service and everything else, okay? So Devereaux's doing what here? I'm untouchable. None of you can even get close to me, okay? So Bartimaeus shows up after a bit because Nathaniel sees Simon Loveless go off by himself. And he follows him. He figures, this is my chance. I'll jump him. He's a 12-year-old scrawny kid. Now, Simon Loveless isn't, you know, the Hulk. He's not big and muscular because he's a scrawny magician. But he's a magician. He's got imps and other beings in his control. Nathaniel doesn't have anybody in his control right here. What can he not do to Bartimaeus? He can't summon him. What does he need? He needs a circle. He needs candles. He needs incense. Okay? So he follows Loveless. He's thinking he's going to, you know, clock him over the head with something. And Loveless leads him right into a trap. Takes him to his master, the wrinkly old guy, Morris Schuyler. And Schuyler gives him an offer. Cue Brando, you know, with the cotton in the cheeks. What's the offer? Join us. Kid, you can go a long way. You've got power. You're strong. After we rule, after we die, maybe it can be yours. Now you got to admit, what kind of offer is this? Yeah, it's a pretty damn good one. It's pretty generous. But it would involve kind of selling his soul. Okay? Thank you for using that because I meant to use it in my first class and I forgot. Page 394. Nathaniel says, he could offer up the world and I'd refuse it. Join him, I would rather die. Jesus says, Mark 8:36. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit his soul? Now, does Nathaniel know Mark 8:36? Probably not. Nothing in there about conjuring up Jenny, so he's not going to read it. But I think Stroud clearly does. Okay? Because what has he now been offered? Think about this. This is pretty important. Does he want power? Does Nathaniel want power? Yes, he does. Is he ambitious? Yeah. To put it mildly, okay? He's being offered everything here. He will become what? He will become Simon Loveless's apprentice. Now, this guy could teach him lots. Who will Simon Loveless be after the next hour? Prime Minister. So, goes from being nobody to apprentice to the Prime Minister. All right? Okay. Would that be hard to turn down? You know, you're student body president of a university, and the governor calls you up and says, I'd like you to come be my apprentice so that when my 4 years or 8 years are done, I want you to run as governor. Assuming there were no age limit, you know, kind of a thing. And the governor's deadly serious. Would it be easy to say, nah, I'm not interested? You know, what little thing can you do if you're governor? Speed limits? Those are for little people. Why? You got this highway patrol with you all the time, okay? But no, he says no. So, he has to kill Schuyler, and he does. Admittedly, it's kind of by accident, but he goes up, you know, kicks the foot, make sure he's dead. Put yourself in a 12-year-old's shoes. You just killed somebody. Okay, they were trying to kill you. Get that part even. But you're 12 years old. Do you feel a little something then? Does it slow you down a little bit maybe? Do you pause for a moment and go, oh my God, I just killed somebody. Yeah, but I gotta, you know. He doesn't seemingly even pause at all. Okay? So, Bartimaeus shows up. He tells Nathanael, or Nathanael says, I think he's going to summon, you think? And Bartimaeus mentions the summoning horn sitting there on the lectern. And Nathanael tries to warn everybody, and Jessica Whitwell puts them in the binding stricture so they can't do anything, and they sit there and they watch all hell break loose. He blows the horn, and what happens? In the air in the room. If you're a Doctor Who fan, it's like the crack in the wall. And it gets wider. And reality starts to do what? What does Einstein's theories tell us will happen the closer and closer and closer you get to a black hole? Time and space
bends.
So if time and space bends, what happens to these? They start going weird. Space, if you've ever seen Salvador Dali's Pink, and I can't remember the title of it, but it's the one where there's a table and there's a watch sitting on it, and the watch is folded over the side. What happens here? The chandeliers start to melt. People start to change. Amanda, who's a brunette, goes to having blue hair. Not so odd these days anymore. And then it turns orange. And we see people start to get elongated and sucked off into this rift. Ramuthra is called forth. Notice, we're never told what this thing is. All we know is it's a very, very powerful force from the other place. But it's not more powerful than the force in the amulet. Okay? So, they've got to figure out how to get the amulet and the summoning horn from Lovelace. So, Lovelace calls Ramuthra because he's tired of this kid being a pain in the rear. And Bartimaeus is like, I know the feeling. So he calls Ramuthra and says, dispose of the child first. Then you can eat everybody else. Because who's going to walk out of this room alive? Only him. Okay? And then, you know, once he's done eating everybody, he'll send them back into the other place. Let's see here. So, Jabor comes in, goes after Bartimaeus, and Bartimaeus tricks him into flying into the rift, and we see Jabor slowly get, you know, eaten away. And meanwhile, Lovelace is talking to Nathanael, 434, says, you know, if you had the luck to be apprenticed to me from the start, we might have done great things together. I recognize something in you. It's like looking into a mirror in my younger days. Now, how should Nathanael take that? Ew, no, I don't want to be that way. So what should he decide to do? You ever heard of the word repent? You know what it means? Literally, turn around. It doesn't mean go left. It doesn't mean go right. It doesn't mean take a 95. It means do a 180. Just turn right around, go in the other direction. So if a guy tells you, a really rotten guy, if you meet Adolf Hitler and he goes, you know, I did you. It means, and go in the other direction. Okay?
Lesson today, don't go to art school.
Pardon?
Lesson today, don't go to art school.
Yeah, really. We share what? The same will to power. A very Nietzschean idea, will to power. He wrote a book about that. Right? He says, but Underwood corrupted you. You're soft. So, he now calls his slave, and the slave comes towards Nathanael. Bartimaeus gets away from Jabor. Nathanael tries to take the thing. He gets away. And then Amanda, of all people, page 441, comes up to Loveless. Simon, Simon, how could you? I'm sorry, it had to be. Simon, you promised me. What was the big news at the beginning of this conference regarding Simon and Amanda? We're not told explicitly. It's implied. It's more than that. They're getting married. People came up to her. Oh, Amanda, we just heard the good news. She said, yes, isn't it wonderful? Simon's promise, blah, 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 blah. Okay. And yet, what did we find out about Simon? She's a tool. It's it. Okay? And a fool as well. How could you use me in this way, Simon? After everything you said, you have no honor. I'm warning you, and Nathaniel leaps forward, and he rips the amulet off his neck. So now there's Simon and Amanda, and there's Nathaniel with the amulet. It's his get out of jail card. Loveless tries to order Ramuthra without any effect. He tells Amanda, get off of me. Amanda moves away, and we suddenly realize it's not Amanda. It's Bartimaeus. Okay. Page 443. As he watched, her features slowly altered. A smile of triumphant wickedness spread across her face from ear to ear. Then in a flash, one of her arms snaked out, plucked the summoning horn from Loveless's slackening grip, snatched it away. Okay, and he gets eaten by Ramuthra. So now, what still has to be done? Nathaniel has the amulet. Bartimaeus has the summoning horn. But they still have to deal with the big guy problem. Okay? Who's most likely, he says, to remember the counter summons? Bartimaeus asks Nathaniel, bottom of 444. Nathaniel looks around, and he sees the surviving remaining magicians, which is most of them. And in what state are they in? Are they standing there shoulder to shoulder commanding their genies? No, they're either in shock, or they're all piled at the doorway, scrambling to get out. Okay? And he says, none of them, by the looks of things. We got to try, Bartimaeus says. Come on, neither of us knows the incantation. Speak for yourself, I know it. You? Are you sure? Possibility hadn't even occurred to you, had it? Yes, I've learned it. Okay. He's only recently turned 12, right? Like within the last week. There's more than in a doubt of his voice. He goes, no time for false pride, boy. You better be sure. You could still ask for help? No, I don't think so. Who's he going to ask for help from? Stand away. I need space to think. It's like, okay. I guess we're all dead here. At least it won't be an eternity with old Chokey, you know. A host of inner voices were speaking at him, and he could not shut the clamor out. This was his moment. This is what Nathaniel's thinking. This was the moment when 1,000 insults and deprivations would be cast aside and forgotten. He knew the incantation. He had learned it long ago. He would speak it and everyone would see that he could not be overlooked again. Always, always, he'd been underestimated. Or as George Bush famously called it, misunderestimated. Underwood had thought him an imbecile, a fool with barely the strength to draw a circle. He had refused to believe his apprentice could summon a genie of any kind. Loveless had thought him weak, childishly soft-hearted. He had refused to accept that Nathaniel had killed Skylar, too. Always, always, they cast him down. What's he wrestling with?
Self-worth.
No, this isn't conscience.
Self-worth.
Self-worth. This is his sense of injured or wounded pride. Nobody thinks I can do it. I'm tired of people. What? Thinking too little of me. Now was the moment when everything was in his hands. Too often before he'd been rendered powerless. Now what? He's got the words of power. He's got the magical horn. The outcry of his wounded pride almost overwhelmed him. In John Milton's Paradise Lost, which is about the loss of paradise by Adam and Eve and the fall of the demons, He describes Satan as suffering from two things: a sense of injured merit and wounded pride. Kind of like God overlooked him. Why? Because he raised Jesus within the poem, kind of to be the higher of the two. Milton was not, quote unquote, orthodox theologically. He was what's called an Arian. Most people think. Okay? Nathaniel's dealing with the same thing. Nobody expects anything good from him. But then he hears other voices. At the deeper core of his being, beneath this desperation to succeed for his own sake, that's this. It is all about me, damn it. Everybody else be screwed. What does he hear? He hears somebody over there cry out in fear. And a shudder of pity ran through him. What is pity? Pity's never for yourself, unless you're throwing a pity party, which is why it's called that. Because pity parties, from another person's perspective, are never good. Pity is always directed where? Outwardly. It's always looking at somebody else's interests, somebody else's problems. Okay? What's the difference between walking down the street, seeing a homeless person, and saying, oh man, it sucks to be homeless, and then just walking on your way? Or walking down the street, seeing a homeless person, saying, man, it sucks to be homeless, and buying them lunch, and then going on your way. Okay? That's mercy. You feel the pity, you show mercy. Mercy means they are somewhat under your control or power. In other words, you can change their situation. Maybe not forever. But what can you change for a hungry person? You can kill the hunger pains. Okay? He hears the cry. He feels pity. Unless he can bring the spell to mind, the hapless magicians were going to die. Notice, it's not just about him anymore. He's thinking outwardly. He's thinking of others. Okay? Their lives depended on him. And he had the knowledge to help. Now, how did that go? And he keeps hearing them. He thinks about Mrs. Underwood. He thinks about the flames. Tears run down his face. He hears those words from Ms. Lutyens, and he goes in his mind back to where? If you've ever practiced meditation, how do you always begin with meditation? Put yourself in a comfortable place. Not only physically, but here. Go to a good place. For some people, it's the beach. For some people, it's the mountains. For some people, it's a meadow. For some people, it's the middle of a screaming city. Crazy. And what does he think? He thinks of when he first read those words. And we're told, top of the next page, as he gets clearance in his mind, he remembers the words that he learned sitting on the stone seat a year or more ago, when he was 11 or possibly even 10. And notice, none of these other magicians can help right now. But this kid who learned to spell at 10 or 11, can, says the words, and at the 15th syllable, breaks it in two. And then what does he do? He takes the amulet, okay? He carries it by its chain, and it's not like he does this. Okay, everybody see this? Great! Look up there. You see this? Everybody's watching. Look what I'm about to do. Is that what he does? It's kind of what Bartimaeus describes it as. Or does he just walk carrying it like this so they see the amulet? And he puts it in the prime minister's hands. What's he doing when he's putting the amulet in the prime minister's hands? He's giving up power. Because what does that amulet do? You can't touch me. And you can't touch me. And none of you all together can touch me. Okay? typical of the kid that was. This is a big chance. He seized it in the most theatrical fashion possible. What a performance! Right? Wherever the prime minister goes, there goes the thing. We're told. So, we're going to skip a bunch. He tells the prime minister everything that happened, right? Everything? Yeah, I sent my Jenny off to Lovelace's place. Adam nicked the amulet. No, he skips over all of that. How does Arthur Underwood come out of this whole passage? Well, he's a hero. He suspected Lovelace. So Lovelace came to his house and killed him. Did Arthur Underwood ever suspect Lovelace? No. Nathaniel's woven this lie into part of his public history. That becomes part of the propaganda. What about everything about Nathaniel being a hero? Bottom of 456. You're a hero, Nat. Yeah, that's what the prime minister said. Ooh, do you hear that? You're what? All the not cheering. What's Bartimaeus' point? Nobody knows what you've done. Well, you know, national security. We have to keep it a secret. No. Bartimaeus is saying, they're keeping a secret. Why? How would it look to find out a 12-year-old saved the government? How much trust would there be in the government? What would commoners do? Yeah, okay. So, what does he say? I kept my promise. Keep yours. Let me go. Okay? He says, you know, you don't let me go. What's going to keep me from going down and telling Jessica Whitwell right now the whole truth? He said, the 10? He goes, yeah, you're right. That could screw me over. But then where would you be, too? What would happen if Bartimaeus goes down and tells Jessica Whitwell everything? Do you think Nathaniel's going to get off with a slap on the wrist? Or is he going to end up in the Tower of London? Because, bear in mind, who is ultimately responsible for all of this? It's his fault. His master is dead. It's his fault. Okay? So he'd probably have several life sentences, if not capital punishment. Okay? So, page 459, Bartimaeus says, dismiss me. I kept my vow. You're a genie. Vows mean nothing to you. You're confusing me with a magician. He says, okay, come on. Here's your problem. You're too clever for your own good. A lot has happened because you were too clever to let things lie. You wanted revenge. You summoned a noble genie. You stole the amulet. You let others pay the price. You did what you wanted, and I helped because I had to. Okay? So I could go down and tell her. He says, okay. So, Nathaniel draws the circle. He writes the runes. Bartimaeus is like, so this is all good now, right? He says, well, before you do it, one thing. What? Listen. What's he going to tell him and why? For a magician, you've got potential. And I don't mean the way you think I mean. What's the way Nathaniel understands that? You could go all the way to the top, man. What does Bartimaeus mean?
Integrity.
You have integrity? Nobility? You can use it for good. In other words, you can be good, John. Not just meaning competent. Bartimaeus means it in a morality sense. You still have a conscience. For a start, you've got more initiative than most of them. But they'll crush it out of you if you're not careful. Okay? First lesson, you've got initiative. Don't let them kill it. Two, you've got a conscience. And that's rare and easily lost. Don't lose it, is what he's saying. Oh, and the third thing?
Watch out for your master.
Why? Who's his master? Jessica Whitwell. Why should he be careful of her? Is she corrupt? Or how do you get to that position?
Ambition.
without maybe a little climbing over the ladders, the people ahead of you on the ladder, by knives in their backs, you know? You know where the bodies are, so to speak? You know where people's skeletons are hidden? Okay. So why does he give this advice? What is your impression of Bartimaeus when you get to the end of the novel as opposed to the beginning? Okay. Doesn't he almost come across to some extent like a father figure? Mm-hmm. I mean, he actually says at one point, I wanted to put him over my knee. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, hold on to that as you start the